Greetings from Sri Lanka. My presentation today will focus on the National Monitoring and Evaluation Systems and Practices in Sri Lanka, the experiences, good practices, challenges and the way forward. Let me first introduce myself. I am Sivagnanasothy. I am called Siva, Secretary, Ministry of Traditional Industries and Small Enterprise Development. And also I was formerly the Director General of the Department of Foreign Aid and Budget Monitoring of the then Ministry of Plan Implementation. Today's presentation will focus on the Managing for Development Results Strategy, MFDR strategy introduced in Sri Lanka. And also I will discuss about the National Electronic Project Monitoring System introduced in Sri Lanka. And then I will also discuss about the national evaluation arrangements, evaluation methods, practices in Sri Lanka, and also I will highlight some of the key issues, challenges and the way forward. Sri Lanka has been introducing Managing for Development Results, MFDR. And as you all know, governments are increasingly being called upon to be accountable for results. Citizens, parliamentarians, media, all expecting the national public management to focus beyond inputs, activities and outputs towards outcomes and impacts. So the results are becoming more and more important. The ministries and departments have been in the past process oriented and they need to be results oriented. And also they need to have an objective and fair basis to assess the performance of ministries and departments was considered as a fundamental thrust for introducing the Managing for Development Results, or we may call it results-based management. So Sri Lanka has institutionalized Managing for Development Results, and one of the important aspects in Sri Lanka is that the results framework and key performance indicators have been introduced and institutionalized at the National Development Plan, at the sector plan level, at the ministries and departments, and even at the project level. And if I take a case in point, the ministries how, and departments, how the Managing for Development Results have been introduced, we have basically two approaches. One is to have an agency results framework, which we call it ARF, and then we call it the agency scorecard. Every ministry is expected to identify their vision and mission in terms of their national development plan, in terms of the broader national development plan. So the ministries will have to first develop their vision and mission, and also they have to identify their thrust areas, or we call it the core business areas. Once they identify that, they will have to identify their goals and they will have to come out with key performance indicators, setting out their baseline, the current situation and the medium term targets. So this is the agency results framework every ministry has to have, and this agency results framework has to be aligned to the government's national development strategy, which is called the Mahinda Chintana Vision for the Future. Once they have their results framework with well-defined targets and indicators, and then they will have to measure their performance against what is called a scorecard, and if their performance is slipping, then you will have a red alert, and if they are doing well, then they will have a green, you know, sort of a traffic light signal. So this signal mechanism is also there as scorecards. These systems have been introduced based on best practices in other part of the world, especially in USA, the Oregon states, where they call it the Oregon benchmarks, the Minnesota milestones, and in the Virginia states, we have the Virginia scorecards. We have followed those models, and also we have taken best practices from those models, and also New Zealand, and we have localized to the country context, and the Sri Lankan results-based management, or Managing for Development Results, is context-specific, but based on outside external best practices and experiences. And if you look at the MFDR in Sri Lanka, it has been institutionalized through a budget call that was sent in 2010. And also prior to that, also the National Administrative Reform Council, through its circular, has compelled all the ministries to put out their results frameworks. These results frameworks are in two steps approach. One is a comprehensive results framework, where every ministry has to have their mission, vision, thrust areas, goals and key performance indicators, and also they have to have a mini results framework for their budget purposes. Now what you can see here in the presentation is a mini results framework where the Ministry of Health has prepared, and there you can see they have identified their thrust areas and they have their key performance indicators. The baseline is there, and also they have their target set, and the targets will show in the medium term how they would like to achieve and what their outcomes are. You can see here under curative and preventive health care, they have the percentage of underage children and where they would like to reduce it from 23% to 21%. Similarly, there are various indicators. If you take incidence of EPI, target diseases, TB rate, 100,000 population, they would like to bring it down from the baseline of 42 to 38. You can see similarly immunization coverage. So these indicators, some of which are outcome indicators, some of which are output indicators. Outputs are attributable, so therefore we had the attribution aspect also incorporated in the results framework, whereas we are also more focusing on results and outcomes. So you have both combined outcome indicators as well as output indicators. And if you look at the results framework, what it communicates is, it communicates basically the four aspects of results-based management. Where are we now? That is the baseline situation. Where do we want to go? Basically setting out key performance targets for medium term. And how do we get there? Basically the strategies and actions. And how did we do? Basically measuring the performance and monitoring and scoring. So this framework is applied throughout, and the results-based management is not only at the project level, not only at the ministry level, but also the development plan is also basically results based. And why Sri Lanka has been taking this forward, and what elements have been supporting this, what fundamental prerequisites are essential? Political will and policy environment is fundamental. A government policy has been very supportive to introduce MFDR. There were champions, Ministry of Finance and Planning, the then Ministry of Plan Implementation, and the line ministries have taken a leadership. And also you have change agents. Change agents are even statutory boards, corporations, the chairmen and the board and the relevant directors also take this strategy forward. There is a comprehensive strategy on results-based management, and also there is serious buy-in from the line ministries, the Auditor General, the National Planning Department, and also we do have a community of practice where we discuss about the results-based management, share with other ministries, and there is a forum to communicate and discuss, and also we have Sri Lanka Evaluation Association and other forums where we share and learn from each other. And also we have statistical information, capacity building is also fundamental, and we have got support from the Asian Development Bank, from the UNDP to build up our managing for development results and results-based management system. So what we want to see is results and not just efforts. The results-based management focus is all about outcomes and results. So now let me talk a little bit about the National Electronic Project Monitoring System. In Sri Lanka, we also have a national monitoring system in the country, and this system is implemented in the Ministry of Finance and Planning under the Department of Foreign Aid and Budget Monitoring. This system broadly expects all the line ministries and the project directors to feed their project-related information in the system. It is a web-based system, and it includes the all development projects, major development projects over $5 million, basically all big projects, and also the information comprises of project profile, financial progress, the physical progress, the results, outcomes and results, and also key issues, and also there is a results framework where comprehensively we monitor the outcomes at each level. Basically the results framework is mainly the logical framework which looks at the logic of the project, the program theory, and also objectives at different levels, goals, purpose, output and inputs, and the objectively verifiable indicators are there, and the means of verifications are there, and the external assumptions and risks are there, and the monitoring is based on the logical framework approach. And also the National Electronic Project Monitoring System also includes pictorial evidences. If you look at the salient features, the National Electronic Project Monitoring System basically is a paperless, introduces a paperless monitoring capability. Data is captured at source, and we are having an early warning signal. When the project is not performing well, it alerts. There is an alert on sick projects, and also it provides pictorial proof. So it's a fairly comprehensive monitoring system which tracks all development projects in a systematic manner. Basically, when I say all, over $5 million. So let me now also give a briefing on the evaluation system that Sri Lanka has. Sri Lanka believes very strongly on evaluation. Evaluation is considered as a fundamental tool and a mechanism and a methodology for evidence-based decision making. We have ongoing evaluations where evaluations are done on ongoing projects and programs, and we have ex post evaluations where evaluations are done after the completion of the project to see whether the project objectives have been achieved, the project outcomes have been realized, and also we have impact evaluation methodologies and systems to see whether the impacts have been achieved or not. So this evaluation system is not covering all projects and programs, but it is done on a selective basis, and we have certain criteria. When it comes to evaluation, we have two basic objectives: accountability for performance or results, that is one aspect, and the lessons learning is other aspect. So we are focusing on both accountability for results and learning. But recently our thinking has been more shifting towards learning lessons, because we want to make sure that the evaluation is a powerful tool for learning and also sharing the experiences and then re-correcting, taking corrective actions. So dissemination and feedback is very, very fundamental, and we have recently introduced what is called a web-based evaluation information system. There are the evaluation findings, lessons learned, overall assessment of the projects and programs, follow-up actions and recommendations. All these things are loaded in the evaluation information system, and the system feeds information, and planners, policymakers can look at the system, learn from the system. The system also synthesizes, summarizes the evaluation findings at a project level and also at the sector level. Moreover, we also go for outsourcing of evaluation. Sometimes when there is capacity constraints, when we have difficulties in capacity, we outsource evaluations also. And Sri Lanka very, very strongly advocates for joint evaluation. When donors are undertaking donor-driven evaluation, we always suggest that the donors should not do on donor evaluations, but it should be a joint and collaborative evaluation in line with the Paris principles, where the ownership is also, government also takes a lead in the ownership, so that the evaluation will become finally owned by the government and also finally incorporated into planning, policy making, budgeting and the whole process, development process. So therefore we believe in joint evaluation, and we encourage donors to work with us closely, collaborate with us, and not to have purely donor-driven evaluation, but more joint evaluations where country also benefits and the evaluation gets owned and institutionalized. Moreover, we have Sri Lanka Evaluation Association, which is also a professional association where government, civil society, non-governmental people also participate, and this enhances evaluation culture, and we have various conferences and so forth. In addition to that, evaluations have been done on many projects, many programs and even policies, including we participated in the Paris Declaration evaluation in the first phase, where evaluation done was aid effectiveness. So with regard to evaluation methodology, we follow the OECD DAC methodology. The OECD DAC strongly believes on the DAC criteria, basically the relevance, the efficiency aspect, the effectiveness, the impact and the sustainability. So we have a evaluation system which goes by OECD DAC criteria, and we have the weightages, and we have a rating scoring system where we score on the performance of projects on basically on the criteria relevance, efficiency, effectiveness, impact, and so on. And then we rate the project. Finally, it was highly successful, successful, partly successful, and unsuccessful. More importantly, not only the overall assessment is important, but also the lessons learned, the key issues and problems, and the follow-up actions and recommendations are identified in the evaluation report, and this is basically discussed. And we are currently, although the dissemination is good, we also feel there is a need to strengthen the evaluation feedback. This is weak basically in Sri Lanka. We want it to be strengthened, and we want the evaluation, dissemination and feedback to be more stronger, so that findings are incorporated very strongly into the planning, budgeting and policy making process. And Sri Lanka also has an evaluation information system, as I said to you earlier, a database on evaluation. And this evaluation is not just only project evaluations are incorporated. Any evaluations done by even outside agencies are also captured into this evaluation information system. It's a web-based information system. And we synthesize the evaluation findings, and the snapshots on the evaluations are provided in the report, because normally, you know, evaluation reports are bulky in nature. So therefore, government officials, senior officials do not have much time to go through these bulky documents. Therefore, we are trying to synthesize those evaluations, summarize the findings, and we are only getting the overall assessment, the key issues, the lessons learned, and the follow-up actions and recommendations. Those synthesis are placed in the project evaluation system. And also finally, we have a sector synthesis. Basically, if there are 15 to 20 road projects evaluated, we get the findings of those road sector projects evaluated, and those synthesis are also kept in the evaluation information system, so that it helps busy policy makers to draw lessons and use in their planning process. So we are trying to put the evaluation information system in a stronger way, so that the feedback will be ensured. So in a nutshell form, Sri Lanka has been strongly focusing on institutionalizing managing for development results in line with the Paris principles, the Paris Declaration on Aid Effectiveness, which also strongly advocates for managing for development results. Sri Lanka is also on its way towards having a country-owned monitoring and evaluation system, where we have a web-based national monitoring system, and not only at the national level, but also at the line ministry level, there are periodical progress review meetings conducted, and progress is reviewed, and troubleshooting forums are there. Similarly, we also have an evaluation system where we do not undertake all the projects, but we selectively undertake few project evaluations, and these evaluation findings are disseminated, and we are trying to further strengthen our evaluation capacity, because evaluation requires capable professionals. So Sri Lanka is concentrating on its capacity development in the evaluation area. So these are the broad areas that we are working on with regard to M&E and broadly. And Sri Lanka has also been going on the performance budgeting part. And also our auditing systems are shifting from traditional audits to performance audits. So the government is overall moving towards results-based management. And we are concerned about the long-term outcomes, the long-term results, and the sustainability. I hope I have very briefly set out the monitoring and evaluation framework in Sri Lanka. Thank you very much for giving me this excellent opportunity.